Welcome back, everybody. Brian here. Have you ever felt like you needed to, well, get away from it all? Want to be away from life, the universe, and everything? Well, I have a solution for you. Islands, the best place to get away from it all. And good news for you that we're in Europe, and the continent is home to literally thousands of islands. So today, let's find out, what are the big islands of Europe? And what other major islands are a part of Europe? So, to help you pick one out to get away on, let's dive in. What are the big islands of Europe? Let's begin with a few of the big islands so you can make a good choice about where to get away from it all, shall we? Great Britain. Probably the single most impactful island we'll talk about in regards to its effects on history, culture, politics, religion, and international relations, Great Britain is the largest island which is part of continental Europe. At just over 80,000 square miles and home to over 64 million people, Great Britain contains the countries of England in the middle of the island, Wales to the west, and Scotland to the north. However, as Great Britain was mostly carved by glaciation, there are many, many islands which are considered to be a part of Great Britain. So, let's hit the highlights. Isle of Wight. Coming from the Celtic word wythe, meaning island, the Isle of Wight is off the south coast of England, is a part of the UK, and is the second most populous island of the United Kingdom behind Great Britain itself. Isle of Man. Sitting in the Irish Sea, or the body of water between Great Britain and Ireland, the Isle of Man's people speak a very rare Gaelic language called Manx. The Isle of Man is one of the few places on Earth which was granted Biosphere Reserve status by UNESCO, which is a recognition of people living in balance with their environment. Channel Islands. Named for their position in the English Channel, the body of water in between southern England and France, the Channel Islands are an archipelago, many of which are uninhabited, with the exception of the islands of Jersey and Guernsey, part of the United Kingdom and with a combined population over 170,000. Often called the Emerald Isle for its expansive rolling green hills and meadows, Ireland was primarily covered in woodlands until the medieval period when it was deforested by both Vikings and later people from England. It is the second largest island of continental Europe and home to both the Republic of Ireland, an EU member, and Northern Ireland, a part of the United Kingdom. Iceland. Settled in the 9th century CE by Scandinavian explorers, the island has a more mild climate than you would think due to its location close to the North Atlantic Current, a river of warm water which sweeps up from the Caribbean. Iceland is a product of volcanism, and the central plateau of the island is almost constantly experiencing an eruption or release of some kind. It may not be the safest, but it does mean a significant amount of geothermal power for Iceland's 371,000 people. Greenland. While anything but green, Greenland is the largest non-continental island in the world, and outside of Antarctica, the only landmass to have a permanent ice sheet, which covers over three-quarters of the island. Greenland is associated geographically with North America, but its long connection to Scandinavian countries and the fact that it's still a part of the country of Denmark today mean that it's often thought of as Europe. Legendarily, a Viking named Eric the Red called Greenland to attract settlers there. Sly. What other major islands are part of Europe? So, if you're not feeling any of the big ones, then don't worry, we've got you covered. Let's talk about a few more of the thousands and thousands of islands of Europe. The Arctic Islands. We'll begin with a few that you can quickly eliminate. The Arctic Islands are two different groups of islands which fall in, you guessed it, the Arctic Circle. Svalbard. An archipelago which lies in between Norway, the country which the islands belong to, and the North Pole. If the term Arctic wasn't enough to let you know, its proximity to the North Pole should also tell you that it's pretty cold. 60% of the islands are covered in glaciers, while the rest of the land was used for coal mining and whaling outposts in the past. Novaya Zemlya. Meaning new land in Russian, this archipelago has the easternmost point in Russia. Cape Flissingskie of the Northern Ireland. This island is known for military bases and nuclear weapon test sites. So, anything appeal here? They're definitely isolated. No? Well. The Atlantic Islands. So, let's try some of these. The Atlantic certainly isn't the Arctic, but before we leave the North... The Faroe Islands. An autonomous territory with connections to Denmark, the Faroe Islands, for being relatively isolated, are home to about 50,000 people, many of whom speak a unique language of North Germanic origin, Faroese, which developed on its own with the isolation of the people here. The Madeira Islands. The location of the kickoff for the Age of Discovery, according to Europe, or the Age of Colonization for pretty much everyone else, the Madeira Islands were settled by Portuguese sailors in 1419 and are a part of Portugal today. Used at first for cereal or food crops, the Madeira Islands became known for Madeira wine and for tourism, as the island hosts 2 million visitors per year for not only the wine, but the mild year-round climate. The Canary Islands. At only 120 miles off the coast of Morocco, this Spanish possession was a stopover station for Spanish galleons as they headed to South America in the 15th and 16th centuries. The Canary Islands are volcanic, with Mount Teide, that you can see in the picture here, being the third highest volcano in the world when measured from the sea floor, and very steep-sided. The islands are home to almost 2 million people, largely living on the islands of Tenerife and Gran Canaria. The Mediterranean Islands. I'm sure we're going to find something for you here. Let's begin with... Malta. Technically an archipelago, though only three of the islands are inhabited, the Independent Republic of Malta has had verified habitation since at least 5900 BCE. With no permanent lakes or rivers, but plenty of good harbors, Malta has been used as a stopover for every major empire and army for at least the last 2500 years. Corsica. This French possession is easily the most mountainous of the Mediterranean islands, with two-thirds of the land covered by mountainous terrain. Corsica was the birthplace of Napoleon Bonaparte, and also the island where Greek sailors believed sirens lived and would sing to lure men to their doom. Sardinia. Just south of Corsica, Sardinia, the second largest island in the Mediterranean and a part of Italy, is home to 1.6 million people, and with its combination of mountains, beaches, forest, and uninhabited plains, has often been called a microcontinent due to its ecosystem variety. Sicily. Located just to the west of the Italian peninsula and looking like a rock ready to be kicked by Italy, Sicily is the largest island of the Mediterranean and home to Mount Etna, which at over 11,000 feet is one of the tallest and most active volcanoes in the world. Something uniquely Sicilian is the fact that the high mountains on the island allow not only for a Mediterranean climate zone, but a transition zone and even an alpine climate. Crete. The largest of the Greek islands, which we'll talk a little bit more about in a minute, Crete is one of the most populous in the Mediterranean, as over 630,000 people call it home. Crete has evidence of inhabitation for over 100,000 years and is a place steeped in history and myth, as both the Minoans, or the forerunners of classical Greek civilization, and the Dictaean Cave, legendary birthplace of the Greek god Zeus, can be found here. The Greek Archipelago. Speaking of Greece, estimates put the number of Greek islands, also called the Aegean Archipelago, at anywhere in between 1,200 to 6,000. To the west of the Greek peninsula, you have the Ionian group, with notables such as Ithaca, home of the Greek hero Odysseus, and Corfu, a World Heritage Site known for its Venetian buildings. To the east of the Greek peninsula are the Sporades, which means scattered, and as you can see from the map, they are all over the northern Aegean Sea. The north and east Aegean islands are close to the west coast of Turkey and are claimed by both Greece and Turkey. Next up, the Saronic Islands are just south and east of the Greek mainland and home to Salamina Port, the largest port city in the Greek islands. Southeast of the mainland, the Cyclades Islands contain Santorini, which hosts the still active volcano of Thera, which may have wiped out the Minoan civilization on Crete about 1600 BCE. The Dodecanese are even further southeast and are notable for the island of Rhodes, which had one of the ancient wonders of the world, a copper statue of Apollo over the harbor called the Colossus. Throughout the Balkan Peninsula, the Black Sea, and off the coast of Bulgaria lie dozens more islands, many uninhabited, but all worthy of a look, especially if you're still looking to really get away from it all. Conclusion. Well, from Arctic to Mediterranean, from heavily populated and historic to unknown, we've looked at the big, the not so big, and the vast and diverse groupings of these European islands, so surely we've found at least a couple of getaway ideas for you. So, whether parka or swim trunks, hiking shoes or scuba gear, get ready for an island adventure and keep exploring.